Amen. Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, our only surety, through your inspiration, we dare to call ourselves your disciples. By your grace, enable us to carry the cross and follow you. And in our struggle to persevere, let the Holy Spirit supply us freely from the wellspring of eternal life. You who live and reign with the Father and the same Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Comparing himself to a potter molding clay, the Lord commands the people to turn away from evil so that they are a worthy creation of his hand. A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, "Come, go down to the potter's house, and there I will let you hear my words." So I went down to the potter's house, and there he was working at his wheel. The vessel he was making of clay was spoiled in the potter's hand. And he reworked it into another vessel as seemed good to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me. Can I not do with you, O house of Israel, just as this potter has done, says the Lord? Just like the clay in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. At one moment I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy it. But if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will change my mind about the disaster that I intended to bring on her. And at another moment, I may declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will build and plant it. But if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will change my mind about the good that I had intended to do to it. Now, therefore, say to the people of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, look, I am a potter shaping evil against you and devising a plan against you. Turn now, all of you, from your evil way and amend your ways and your doings. The word of the Lord. We'll pray the psalm responsively, dividing at the asterisk. Lord, you have searched me out and known me. You trace my journeys and my resting places.
And are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips.
But you, O Lord, know it altogether.
You press upon me behind and before. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. For you yourself created my inmost parts. I will thank you because I am marvelously made. My body was not hidden from you. Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book. How deep I find your thoughts, O God.
How great is the sum of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand.
To count down them all, my life would be like yours.
Writing from prison, Paul gives a letter to a runaway slave who is returning to his master. Through faith, master and slave have become brothers in Christ. A reading from the letter of Paul to Philemon. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God, our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty, yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I referred to do nothing without your consent, in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your own owing me even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. The word of the Lord.
Shall bear your spirit.
on page 12 of the booklet. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king going out to wage war against another king will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If he cannot, then, while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So, therefore, none of you can become my disciple if you do not give up all your possessions." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Take up your cross then in his strength, and calmly every danger brave, it guides you to abundant life and leads to victory o'er the grave.
Every time I read this particular gospel from Luke, I'm reminded of something from back in Ohio. And that is that in Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio, which is a suburb of Akron where I come from, back in the 1940s, actually, a minister came to town from Arkansas by the name of Rex Humbard. And Rex Humbard became really one of the first tele-evangelists. He started out with basically nothing and then got people together on Sunday mornings in the theater. And then eventually, through a lot of fundraising and just personal charisma, was able to build something that he named the Cathedral of Tomorrow. And it was a church which for its time that was very different in that it was built in the round. And all of the classrooms and offices were in like the outer ring. And then the inner ring was actually the sanctuary where there was, you know, basically theater seating. But on the ceiling, there was a huge cross, and back in those days, the public schools would once a year bus us all out to the Cathedral of Tomorrow for concerts given by the Akron Symphony Orchestra, because it was a kind of a perfect space for that. And one of the treats was they would always light the cross up, all kinds of different colors and things, and you know, we would ooh and ah. Well, Also on the property, there had been a discount store, which Reverend Humbard bought and turned into a buffet restaurant called the Cathedral Buffet. And the last thing was he was building a facility for his television network. And in order to have the strongest possibility of broadcasting, because this was pre-cable days, he was building a tower. And this tower was supposed to be, I don't remember how many hundred feet high, and it was going to have a restaurant revolving around the top. But there would be also on that same level where the revolving restaurant would be, there would be production facilities, and on the very, very top, there'd be this antenna. Well, things didn't quite go according to plan. And so Reverend Humbard eventually had to give up the ministry there because there were some few scandals about money that came up. And he eventually left town. And another local evangelist who was growing in popularity because of his style, Ernest Angeles was his name, was his name. He ended up buying the Cathedral of Tomorrow and the Cathedral Buffet and the building that was behind, including the unfinished tower. Well, Reverend Angeles died, the ministry is continuing, the buffet is closed, but the tower half done is still there. So I just thought I'd tell you that because, you know, I can't help but think of that. And when I was back in Ohio in August, there it is, still sitting there waiting for someday to be completed. Apparently, he did not pay attention to this particular text about making sure that he had everything he needed before he began to build that tower, so that it could be finished. When Jesus is giving us these words in the gospel today, excuse me, when he gives us these words, I'm sure it certainly grabs your attention. It always grabs mine, besides the tower business. Whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even life itself, cannot be my disciple. When Jesus uses the word hate, it certainly grabs your attention, especially since it's so contradictory in one sense of what Jesus says elsewhere and what the epistles say, because, you know, John's first epistle says God is love. So, you know, why is Jesus talking about you got to hate in order to, you know, be my disciple? How can you follow the God of love if you're hating somebody? And even John himself in his first letter says, if you hate the brother or sister that you see, how can you love the God that you do not see? Jesus uses that term specifically because it would immediately grab the attention of those who were listening to him. Because even in Judaism itself, even though there may be excuses of why they wouldn't have as much esteem or generosity towards their parents because of other commitments they may have made, it still would be a scandal if they ignored their parents altogether. And so Jesus isn't talking about hating them, you know, I can't stand you, I don't want anything to do with you. It's to put priorities on how love is expressed. That loving your mother and father, children, wife, brothers, sisters, and even life itself cannot be on an equal plane with loving God if you want to be a disciple. God has to be first. Your love for God must be there, and it must be consistent, and it must be in the first place. Everything else, as important as it is, has to be in a lesser place. And those are very difficult words, because we don't usually think that way. We would never think of hating our own flesh and blood, whether it's our parents or our children, our spouse or whoever. We would never think of hating our own life, because that's just plain contradictory to the whole thing of being made in God's image and likeness. That's why it's in the context of carrying the cross, of being a disciple, of being willing to count the cost of becoming a disciple of Jesus, to understand that there is a price to be paid for being a disciple. It may never seem that way to us, because it's, you know, easy enough to live day by day, come to church on Sunday, think about God during the week, different times, or maybe every day. But not see that this has to be the primary focus. And it's difficult to hear these words because of the contradiction that they seem to present. Now, when I was on my sabbatical and I was on the 30-day retreat, there was a meditation that I had to do one day that my director of the retreat told me that I needed to do again. Because when I met with him and I said, well, you know, not much happened during this prayer time. And he said, well, why don't you pray it again? And it was in the context of trying to discern a few things for the immediate future of my life in response to what God would be calling me to do. And so finally, the third time I prayed through this, and it was a meditation on the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Remember, in that story, it's Easter day, and these two disciples are getting out of town as fast as they can. And I have always preached on that as being those who were, they were so afraid that they would be the next ones arrested because of Jesus's arrest and supposed resurrection, because they weren't sure about that, that they were getting out of town as quickly as they could. And Jesus, you know, catches up to them, but they don't recognize him immediately. Well, part of the meditation was to picture myself in that scene. So finally, I could see myself there and understanding that they're, you know, running as fast as they can to get back home and feel safe. And yet Jesus catches up to them. And one way or another, I'm in the midst of all of that. And in the midst of that scene, and knowing that, you know, that the disciples were in a hurry to get away, to run away, I sensed the Lord saying to me, what are you running away from? Because the particular things that I was looking at and praying about, that's what came up. You know, what are you running away from? And I was not too happy with that confrontation from the Lord in that context. Because what came out to me was not what I was really hoping to come forth. And so what was happening was what Jeremiah talks about in the first reading today. In that moment, in that confrontation, Jesus was basically saying to me, I need to refashion you. I need to shape you in the way that I need you to be. I'm the one that has called you. I'm the one who has you where I want you to be. And no matter what you think, this is what I think, and this is what I desire. And if you want to be my disciple, this is how you carry the cross. This is how you follow me faithfully. This is how you love your own will and other things less than you love me. And that was painful to hear, because I like doing my own will. I like having things my way. And it's good when God agrees with me. But, you know, that's not quite the way it's supposed to be. So if we look at the psalm even today, God knows you and me better than we know ourselves. God has known us from before we ever became to be. God knows us and knows us being formed in our mother's womb. And as, you know, Psalm 139 talks about at great length, but even in the verses that we have today, it's a reminder of how intimately bound with us God is in knowing us better than we know ourselves, informing us to be the kind of people that he has created us to be and calls us to be, because he wants us and even needs us to be a certain way. It's like in the letter to Philemon that Paul is reminding his old friend, whose slave, Onesimus, whose name, by the way, means useful. So if you see that used a couple times there, it's a play on words with the guy's name, that Onesimus is an escaped slave. And Paul sees him when he gets to Rome, and he converts him. And now that he's converted, he's also being told by Paul, you got to go back to Philemon, your owner. Not because Paul was in favor of slavery, but because that was an act in the one sense of injustice towards Philemon that Onesimus committed by running away and perhaps even having stolen some things to finance his escape. So what Paul is doing is saying, look, Philemon, I'm sending Onesimus back to you. But you got to receive him back, not as an escaped slave, but because he is now baptized and has professed his faith in Jesus Christ. You've got to receive him back as a beloved brother. How the relationship would work out otherwise, Paul isn't trying to spell out, and we don't know. But he's being told, you have to reshape your attitude. You have to open yourself to the grace of God so that you can receive him back as a beloved brother, so that your attitude towards him, as well as any other slaves you might have, will be reflective of your newfound faith as well, and not just keeping things the way they used to be. That's what it means to be a disciple. It means to be willing to continue to learn. And what it means many times is that we, if we are honest and open to our Lord, if we do take the time to reflect daily, to be open daily, even if it's only 5 minutes of our time, to read a little bit of scripture, to follow some kind of a devotional, or even to just sit and be quiet and invoke the presence of our Lord, who dwells with us by the power of the Holy Spirit, and just be present to Christ in that moment, that we might sense what it is that for that day that he wants us to do, or what we know we have to do in a given day, but that we need his grace and strength to carry out so that it's ultimately pleasing to the Lord. It's ultimately our way of living out being a disciple. Because being a disciple of Jesus, being an icon of Christ, does not mean being preachy. It doesn't mean trying to present ourselves as holier than thou. All it means is that we present ourselves to the world around us as we are, and trying to reflect to others the kind of love that Christ shows to us, because he loves us as we are. He loves us in the depths of our very being. And he asks us then to allow that to shape how we see other people. Doesn't matter who they are. And that we try to love them as God loves them. That's our call. And it means that if we keep Christ in central place, if our daily walk with the Lord is attuned to him and what his will is for us, then we're much more likely to reflect his love and goodness than we are if we're all just taken up with ourselves and our concerns and our needs, etc., etc. The Lord doesn't denigrate us for having needs or wants or desires because we're human beings and he made us. If we keep him in the central place, then these other things can be taken care of, will fall into place. It takes us a lifetime, but we have to be willing to start, if we haven't already, of being this kind of a disciple that knows who it is that we are learning from and who it is that we're following. And to strengthen us for that, to encourage us on our way, once again today, Jesus gives us himself, his body and blood and Holy Communion, so that we will know that we are his and that he is ours. Now, I ask you to please stand on page 13 of the bulletin to join together in renewing our profession of faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As scattered grains of wheat are gathered together into one bread, so let us gather our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of God's good creation.
We pray for the church around the world and for the mission of the gospel. For its leaders, Justin of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Paula, our bishop-elect, Chilton, our assisting bishop, and Mike, our rector. The Anglican Church of Australia, its primate, bishops, clergy, and faithful. The Diocese of Province 5, Indianapolis, Northern Indiana, Eau Claire, Northern Michigan, Western Michigan, Chicago, and our companion diocese of Southeast Mexico and Rank South Sudan. Refresh the hearts of your people, deepen our understanding of every good thing we share, and strengthen our partnerships in the faith. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For the well-being of earth and all its creatures, for trees and forests, for all that will yield fruit this season, and for streams and other bodies of water. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For international organizations, for all nations and those in authority within them, especially Joseph, President of the United States, and all federal, state, local officials, grant wisdom to those who govern and raise up citizens who make decisions in their best interest of their neighbors. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For all in need, for those who suffer from disease, who struggle with homelessness, food insecurity, and energy poverty, for the relief and protection of the people of Pakistan in the midst of severe flooding, and those in Mississippi suffering from the same, for those whose family life is difficult, for those listed on our intercessory prayer list, in our intention books, or in today's bulletin, for all in this community who need your help, and for all those we wish to mention now. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For those in our parish celebrating birthdays this week, Amy Cooper and Joel Montgomery, for Laura and Pete Jezioski celebrating their anniversary. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries? God of grace,
hear our prayer.
For this community of faith, for all our labors, begun, continued, and ended in you, that they may glorify your holy name. Bless your people with the strength to live into their many vocations for the sake of the world. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the saints who now rest from their labors, especially Blessed Paul Jones and Blessed Albert Schweitzer. And remember those who have died this past week, especially Thomas Lambert, Richard Warnicki, Father Edward Thompson, and those we wish to mention now. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Inside the front cover, we find the prayer for the mission of our parish. Loving God, through your grace, guide us, the people of Calvary Episcopal Church, to joyfully carry out our mission of growing faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we may develop a living faith that deepens our understanding of you and strengthens our awareness of the needs of others. May we be a transforming light within our parish and within the community. All this we ask in the name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share Christ's peace. Hey, please be seated. First, we welcome our visitors who are with us today. If you do us the favor of filling out a little visitor card that you should find in your pew and place it in the plate or give it to myself on your way out of church. And we all invite you also to please join us for fellowship following the service. Just follow the crowd out that way and then down the long hallway to the right. And because we are a little sparse in numbers today, there's plenty of eats. So if you're hungry, come on down. And even if you're not hungry, come on down. Today's altar flowers are generously given by Laura and Pete Jazorski in celebration and thanksgiving for their 8th wedding anniversary. Next Sunday at the 10:15 service, weather permitting, we will have the service outside, a mass on the grass, followed by a catered meal for our parish picnic. If you want to bring a dessert to pass, you're encouraged to do so, but the main meal will be stuff that's catered, kind of as our way of easing back in, hopefully, to having the picnic annually. There'll also be an 8:00 service in church next Sunday as well. Tomorrow, Labor Day, there is a Eucharist at 9:30 a.m. to pray for those who are in need of work or those who are underemployed, as well as for those who are already employed and who want to give thanks to God for this opportunity to continue to be able to do work that gives meaning and purpose to their lives. Anything else? Anybody on Zoom have any announcements?
Father Mike, I think Rebecca's.
Yes, Rebecca.
I just have a question for next week's Mass at 10:15. Do we need to bring our own seats?
Yes, thank you. Bring your own lawn chair or whatever you want to bring. Should you forget, there will be some extra chairs. Or you can stand the whole time. We did receive a letter from the Batavia Parks Foundation, and it concerns the upcoming celebration of the United Nations International Day of Peace on September the 21st, which I believe is a Wednesday. It will be the first time that Batavia is officially marking this day, and there will be a gathering at the Peace Bridge, so that bridge over the river between City Hall and River Street. So it's the Riverwalk, South Pat Plaza, and the Peace Bridge. And that gathering will be from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. If you can't make the event, you're asked to sponsor a luminaria in memory of a loved one or to send us a message of peace. And all of that information will be available in next week's bulletin, as well as in this coming Wednesday's email newsletter. So we'll get all that information to you. But just so that you're aware that on the 21st, there's that happening from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. If you would then join with me in the offertory prayer on page 17. Lord God, let our praises come before you, so that united in faith, we may worship in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is in the same Christ that your promises are fulfilled. Shadows give way to light, the world is reborn, and humankind becomes a new creation. By offering himself once for all upon the cross, he desired to gather your scattered children, and lifted up in glory, he draws all people to himself as the firstborn among a multitude of his brothers and sisters. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in
Please kneel or be seated. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love, you made us for yourself. When we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, He broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Blessed Albert Schweitzer, Paul Jones, and all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. In union, blessed Jesus, with the Christian faithful across the world, gathered at every altar of your church, where your blessed body and blood are offered this day, I long to offer you praise and thanksgiving for creation and all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace and the hope of glory, and particularly for the blessings given me. I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament, and since I cannot at this time receive communion, I pray you to come into my heart. I unite myself with you and embrace you with all my heart, my soul, and my mind. Let nothing separate me from you. Let me serve you in this life until by your grace I come to your glorious kingdom and unending peace. Come, Lord Jesus, and dwell in my heart in the fullness of your strength. Be my wisdom and guide me in right pathways. Conform my life and actions to the image of your holiness and in the power of your gracious might. Rule over every hostile power that threatens or disturbs the growth of your kingdom, who with the Father and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God in glory, everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. In the Episcopal Church, we invite all baptized Christians to receive Holy Communion. So if you receive Holy Communion in your own church, you are welcome to receive it here. And one other thing, since the time of COVID and continuing for a while yet, we receive communion through these little communion cups. On the top is the precious blood. On the bottom is the host, the body of Christ. So as you approach for communion, I will say to you the body and blood of Christ. You can answer amen. If you're sitting on this side, I ask you to step over that way and then flip it over, receive the body of Christ, flip it back over, receive the blood of Christ, and then put the empties together with the seals on either end, from either end, in the wicker basket that's lined with aluminum foil, either on this side or that side.
Christ.
The prayer after Holy Communion. Let us pray. God of word and sacrament, you nourish your people and give them life. Grant that these gifts of your Son may make us grow in holiness so that we may be worthy to share his life forever through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Love and serve the Lord.